Hi, everybody. Welcome to USG. Before we get started today, I'd just like to invite the new senators to please stand up here so that Justice Aaron Schultz can give you your oath of office. So just line up right in front of here. All right. All right, congratulations, new senators. We are now officially part of the undergraduate student body government. So just a few things to get you started. We have an agenda here today, and we obviously go through it. The bills that are here today are obviously a little bit new for you, so I apologize, but this bill is important, so we need to get it through as quickly as possible. But we will explain the logistics of this bill and what it really means. And then we have a presenter today coming around. We will be presenting about construction on the Mass Boston campus. So please, feel free to ask questions. Feel free to, ask any type of question you want. This is an open conversation. Obviously, we want to abide by Robert's rule, which is on the agenda, and we will go over that. So, without further ado, I call this meeting to order at 3:09. Let's go through roll call. Senator Lubinsky. Senator Benson.
Here.
Senator Bloom.
Here.
Senator Chase. Senator DeRoche.
Here.
Senator Fallardo.
Here.
Senator Falco.
Here.
Senator Ferrari.
Here.
Senator Fisk. Senator Gornio.
Here.
Senator Gornio.
Here.
Senator Hayden.
Present.
Senator Hill.
Present.
Senator Holmes Weaver.
Here.
Senator Ishak.
Present.
Chair Son.
Present.
Vice Speaker Hanzipani.
Here.
Speaker is obviously here. Chair Gooden.
Present.
Chair Barr.
Present.
Senator Kazi.
Here.
Senator Kirk Mullis.
Here.
Senator O'Cure.
Here.
Senator McLaughlin.
Here.
Senator McLean.
Here.
Senator Patel.
Present.
Senator Simmons.
Here.
Senator Small.
Here.
Senator Thorpe.
Here.
Senator Sullivan.
Here.
Now, Robert's rules, you need a motion to do anything. So, is there a motion to approve the agenda?
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? The agenda is approved. Is there a motion to approve the old minutes?
Motion to approve the old minutes.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye?
Aye.
All those opposed? The old minutes are approved. Are there discretionary account expenses to report?
I have one.
Fair enough.
I have one for $16, I think it's $16.50 for posters and special action.
Thank you, Chair Hart. Are there any other discretionary account expenses to report? Saying none, moving on to committee actions. We will begin with campus and community affairs by Chair Hart.
Hello, everyone. It's great to see many faces here. Some reason has started. So basically, I'll be going over what we did in our committee, which is, as Chair said, campus community affairs chair. So basically what we did is we talked about various positions that we can have and Project Kobe doing throughout the year. We also talked about buying Hoot Creek, which we now officially buying, which is a program that will make posting on our social media much easier, so we're posting on our social media for a week. We also talked about having a UST Snapchat, which I thought was really cool. And we've been doing like geo filters during like maybe events that we're having. We also talked about reinventing the advocate and having there be both a paper version and an electronic version. So for some of you, the advocate that we do in CCA, we make it's basically kind of like a summary of what we've done through out of the month. We post like once a month, I think Monday, the first of the month. And basically we talk about like what all the committees have done. And so on, so far, so important that. Lastly, we talked about some legislation that we're working on that pertains to making Robert's Rules and legislation training mandatory. So we're just in the final stages of that, still pretty rough. And last thing I promise. We're also talking about the new editor we're going to make on the UST website. So we're going to look forward to that. If you have any suggestions,
talk to
either myself or
Mary
about that. And we'd love to
discuss
that. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Mark. Now moving into Budget and Finance by Chair
Rubin. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. The Budget and Finance Committee last week, we were visited by the Director of U-Access, LaToya, where we discussed how USD and U-Access can partner in helping bring more access to needs that the student body needs. It was a very in-depth discussion on stuff that they do and how we can assist them. We also approved $400 for ESA fellows to attend the NASPA conference in higher education student affairs in Springfield, Mass. And lastly, SEOC Chair and I had a productive meeting at the Clark Athletic Center where I developed some Club Zero in basketball. And finally, Chair Speaker Lucas actually touched on it a bit, but just because we're in a bigger body right now, feel free to still, raise your voice, ask questions, just like we did in committee last week. Just because there's more people in the room, it doesn't mean your voice should be quiet. We represent the student body, so feel free to any guests that we have, any topics that we bring up, ask questions, make your voice be heard, because you're representing the student body. The more diverse voices that we have, the more the conversation we have. That is all I have to report.
Thank you, Chair Gooden. Now moving on to Student Events and Organizations by Chair Song.
All right, welcome everybody. Just to add on to that, yeah, so I don't want you guys to feel worried and I want you guys to all pitch up your opinion. For me personally, our committee went through accepting new club requests. We went and accepted 5 new clubs and we announced a merger between the Smash Club and the Esports Club. And that is all I have to report.
Thank you, Chair Sun. Now we're moving on to officer reports. Now we'll begin with President reports. Sorry, President Sean.
Hi, everybody. I went around and introduced myself to the military, but if you came in later, my name is P. I'm the student body president for this academic year. Very excited to work with all of you. You're good now?
Okay.
So this past 2 weeks, I apologize for not being here the first day. I was at the investor ceremony, so I'm here now. Vice President Truth and myself met with Chancellor Barry Mills on Monday, talked about the three things that Sarah and I really want to work on, so transparency, student involvement, and accessibility on campus. Barry was very willing to help all of us in any way that he can, so that was very reassuring. And he wants us to get a survey out to students to see what are 5, 10, 15 things that they want to see fixed, and he will do everything as hard to fix them. So Sarah and I are working on getting a survey out then. Today, I met with Lori Parkin and Denise Dugan. Lori Parkin is the ADA contractor, Denise Dugan works for facilities. We just talked about accessibility on campus, so the pavers in the plaza, ramps, doors to buildings, the elevators being repaired, as well as sidewalks. The pavers were supposed to be fixed over the summer, however, the pavers, there's a lot of them that need to be fixed, so it came from a minor fix to now they have to hire a contractor and they have to do a little bit more since it's now out of a minor repair. So that is in the process of being fixed. If anybody comes up to you and they want to know why they haven't been fixed, that is in the process. We went over ramps, the doors, and the calibration of like university hall doors, those are being checked as well. The elevators, all of the one in the academic buildings, they're mostly being fixed. Right now, the two ones in McCormick are being fixed. Those should be done within the next week or two. But other ones are being fixed as well. So just keep updated and tell students to look at the construction of these because that has all that information on there. Last week, Shelby, Sarah, and myself, and a couple other people from the Campus Center had a video conference call with the University of Limerick in Ireland. We are working on getting a student life partnership with them, so we are talking with them. Sarah and myself are tabling on Monday from 11 to 1. Please feel free to stop by if you'd like to be there. It's really just a meet and greet so people know Sarah and myself as well as the undergraduate student government. And then two kind of plugs. I received an email from Kyle Bueno from Bridgewater State. They are holding a meeting on October 17th for a public higher ed and kind of how state universities can come together to get more funding for public higher ed. If you are interested, come see me afterwards. I can get you in touch with them. As well as SAP, their communication thing, they are doing an event at Boston Public Library on October 16th. And this is what their coordinator emails me. The content is aimed at students and young professionals. The event will feature a panel discussion with young members of U.S. Congress, including Representative Joe Kennedy, and conversation will be followed by a reception and book signing with SAP CEO Bill McDermott. So if you're interested in that for free event, contact me so I can get in contact with them. Thank you. I have nothing else to report.
Thank you, President Pitano. Now moving on to Vice President Port by Vice President
Hello, everyone. Welcome to all the new senators. I hope you guys are all having a nice semester, especially the freshmen. So I have a few things to report. Katie and myself had a meeting with the chair from New Access. It is located on the second floor in Post Life. She is the coordinator for student welfare, and she was telling us about New Access and what they do. And we worked a lot with New Access last year, and we want to continue that. And for to continue that, we would do prior to the semester, maybe two if you have time. And then also, they have a new food pantry now. They had a very large space on the side of the now, they have a new food pantry. And then they have the opening, I believe, in November. So once we get the flyers, we'll be set to share part. We'll be putting it on Facebook and social media, and you guys are welcome to go to that. And Katie and myself heard a few students say that it would be really nice to have microwaves library or in the new hall because we don't have microwaves there. Students have to come to Campus Center or go to IUC from their food. So once we have our final budget for the USG, we will contact the dean of the library and see how we can fund them or what we can do to help those students. And also, I had a meeting with Keith Walk. He is the Associate Director of Residential Education. As you guys know, we are going to have rest halls next year. That is pretty exciting. And the rest halls, they have the Rest Hall Association, which in most cases, they work together with the student government. So we had a meeting to discuss how we can work together with them. Sometimes they have student associated with their meetings, and then they have ours. And they work on projects, they work together. So we will be working on that for throughout the semester.
Vice President Tariq. Now moving on to speaker reports. So welcome everybody. Obviously, you've been getting a lot of emails from me. But let me just talk to you about what I have to remind you of what I have sent out. So the retreat we're having is on Friday. We will be meeting in my office around 2 o'clock, and then we will be departing campus at 3 o'clock and arriving around 5 o'clock at Camp Woodstock in Connecticut. October 4th, next week, we will be taking profile pictures. So obviously, committee meetings are a little bit more casual than General Assembly. So that meeting, I would ask again to please dress business casual. The tasks that I sent out, those I'm just trying to keep them, you know, simple enough that people who have work or have a, you know, responsibilities are able to accomplish their 3 hours required by the bylaws. Again, just to reiterate, all you have to do is create an account at umbgov.com, which is our website. Second is join the student government on UMB Involved. Third is to like the USG Facebook page. And the last one is just, you know, meet new people. Meet 10 new people that are here today. That way you can accomplish that task pretty easily. You can introduce yourself, you know. So I added a new line item here, which is G on the agenda. It's called Senator Reports. So if anybody has anything to report the way we are doing now, you know, just something that, you know, you saw or something that happened and you want to say something, I have allocated time for you to do that. So rather than waiting until open forum or anybody, you can get your business out of the way and continue on having that conversation. And open forum is usually more for debate. This report is just what we have to report on. That's all I have to report for today, and I'll move it on to a speaker report done by my speaker.
Thank you. Great, welcome everyone. A couple of things to keep in mind. I keep keeping track of everyone's contact information. That way we can email you or kind of forward any messages that we need. So everyone will see the kind of this voting piece of paper right on their seat. Yeah, if you guys don't mind just including your full name, your email, your phone number if you're comfortable, and your committee. That would be great, and you can just like pass that back to me at the end of GA. Also, just a reminder, we do have the business casual dress code along with attendance. Just a reminder, everyone should only has 3 unexcused absences. So we do keep track of that, so that's just something to keep in mind, and that is all I have to report. Thank you.
Thank you for reminding. Now moving on to Chief Justice reports done by Chief Justice Sol.
So, the new senators, and I'll be here with you, but everyone is welcome to ask questions. But it's my plan for a couple of presentations that will help you understand Robinson, as well as writing legislation that are planned for the next upcoming GAs. The Robinson one is pegged for the next GA. So, I would encourage you to have any questions after.
Trustee positions in the overview. It's a little different. It's ex officio. So University of Massachusetts system is governed by a board of trustees that kind of oversees policy, a lot of the buildings that go up, finances of universities. And so each campus gets to elect a student to sit on the board and kind of represent student interests. So that's what I have kind of the privilege of doing this year. In regards to what has happened so far in the year, I work pretty closely with Kate and Sarah on their initiatives and help out where I can. In regards to the board, there have been 2 meetings so far and 1 board cycle where all the committees, all different committees meet. At the first meeting in July, tuition was raised $393 for in-state students and around $890-something for out-of-state students. It was voted unanimously by the board with the exception of one student trustee. That happened in that regard. At the regular trustee meetings, they go over honorary degrees that happen at the end. We did that. We're also following very closely Mass Boston's financial situation. If you're not familiar with it yet, I'm sure coming here in coming months as you get more involved in the campus, we'll kind of recognize that the university is in a tricky financial spot. And so the board is working very, very hard to, as well as everybody on this campus, to right the ship, if you will. So that's a little bit what I do. But I've been doing, if there's any questions, my office is on the third floor. Come say hi. I'm more than happy to answer any questions you have. Thank you for the forward work with you for the year.
Thank you, Student Trustee Malkowski. Now, again, does anybody have anything to report?
Hey everybody, I'm Senator Paladino. I think what I wanted to report is I was just at lunch about an hour ago and I was talking to some people and they said that in the cap, the microwaves in the back near the charging station have failed. They're not operating, none of them. They have no power to them apparently. I just want to put that, let's whoever needed to know about that to know so we can see if we can get that resolved.
Thank you, Senator Paladino. Does anybody else have anything to report?
Hi, my name is Senator Royal. I work at UAccess, and there was a girl who came in, I believe she's a freshman, and she discussed that the religious group that came today, she was crying, and she was talking about how she felt attacked. You know, with religious freedom, you're able to say it, but they were talking condescendingly to her and telling her she was a sinner. She felt like she wasn't, like, welcome, so I just wanted to know if there was a way we could, you know, tell them that you can preach what you want, but you just have to be respectful of other people.
Great. Let me just clarify. Senator reports are the things that are not questions.
Okay.
So if you want to debate that, that's a good topic to debate. Let's save that for open forum. Obviously, you know, we'll get used to it. But it's just if you have something to say. Like, I have spoken with X somebody and they have said this to me, we can talk about it later. That's
okay. Well, likewise, if it was on campus, I heard people who did feel attacked and who were also the target of insults from these people, specifically women being called whores and members of the LGBT community. So, yeah, I think that is fine.
Does anybody else have anything to report? Seeing none, moving on to old business. Seeing that there is no old business, we're moving into new business. And I'm going to moving on to Holly Sutherland's presentation on the construction update because she does have some of the so we're going to move on to that. Holly.
college level and I do master plan and construction communications. I apologize if some of you have heard my little spiel before, but this is going to be an update. And I always have to sort of go back to the settings first, but I'm going to give you a construction update and a master plan update. So, you know, back in the 70s, this campus was very different. We were, before that, in the downtown, Lee's Gas Building downtown. So we were, our home was chosen here out on the peninsula. And the peninsula was a very different place. Columbia Point was a very different place back then. It was a landfill, and it had that castle-like building in the middle is Boston's first sewer station, and back in the 1800s when they pumped the sewerage right into the harbor, that was quite a thing, but not so much when it was ending in the 60s there. So we had that in the middle of the campus, and we had a polluted Boston Harbor, and we also had where the Harbor Point apartments are, we had the Columbia Point project. So the campus was built rather inward. So that's the 70s buildings, all of the brick buildings that you see. It was built inward and always built inward for a purpose. And it had sort of a one-way car-centric racetrack around it. Again, very 70s. Under the 70s buildings, we have upper and lower level garages that are decommissioned because of concrete problems. And hence, that's when we started the master plan. So the state came in and they said for $160 million, we can take you right back to the 70s, or you can look at the strategic goals of the university and put a master plan together. And that's what we did. And this is a framework of the master plan. And you really have to go over and point with it.
So I'll try to talk about it from here. So bearing Marcy Boulevard, Mount Vernon Street. So the first building, the master plan, Integrated Sciences Complex, the second building, University Hall, Rooted Research, the master plan back in 2007, focused on research and academic space. Obviously, we're going to talk about the residence hall, the parking garage, and all of the other sites you see. So back in 2006, when they closed those parking garages, they built surface parking lots, and those surface parking lots, for the most part, are earmarked for buildings, and that's all part of the master plan. And I'll do Bayside Expo. So the master plan is a flexible framework, so back in 2010, the UMass Building Authority, who we work with to build a lot of our projects, they bought the Bayside Expo. That's what we have been using for satellite parking.
So this is a new aerial. Did you pay money and send a helicopter up? No, some crafty person shot this off their TV screen, believe it or not, where the news helicopters had gone up. So I'm going to go over again.
So here's the IFC, the Integrated Sciences Complex. Here's University Hall. Here is the new University Drive South, which I will get into, and the new Fox Point Dock. That's the residence hall. There's the half-pasture pumping station that I was talking about. Also in 2015, the Edmund Kennedy Institute was opened. That we are in partnership with them, but they have their own foundation, and our Senator wants students to learn about the Senate. We probably should have been over there, the long Senate chambers. If you haven't, you should. You can go in for free.
Last year, I will get into the utility corridor and roadway relocation project, so that's why we have dirt piles all around, and I will talk about it more. But when we had the University Drive South closed, we also upgraded our docks. So where we have research and recreational loads out at the Fox Point Dock, We had kind of a mismatch of floats there before, and we've upgraded that, and that's what you see here. Residence hall. So we are very close to opening our first residence hall. It is three buildings. I'm sorry, three wings, two buildings, 1,045 beds, four students. The others are, I believe, for RNAs and so forth. It's opening in fall 2018 and it is on schedule. This is a shot of our webcam.
So, if you go to the website and you type in webcam, you can actually watch this thing go up. And that is, so the residence hall, the UMass Building Authority said great, or the Board of Trustees said great, build a residence hall, but they said they wanted it to be a public-private partnership. So in other words, it doesn't go on our books, and we are not putting money out for the residence hall. So the residence halls are public-private partnerships. So it's Capstone Development Corporation, and then it's Capstone On-Campus Management that is actually doing operations of the residence hall. The Capstone hired a contractor, a local contractor, a local designer to build the residence hall to design it. So we have right here is the east building, here is the west building. How is this easy to do for the first year and 2018? Well, this whole section right here is going to be common space, and it's going to be dining space, 350 dining space, brand new dining space, and student study lounge space, and that is for all students, not just residents. And it's for, I go over here, for staff as well, but that's a very nice feature in fall 2018.
And one of the things to keep in mind in 2018, everything that you see that is under construction will be done. So that's pretty cool. And this is the same view of the residence hall, a rendering when it's done. Again, Capstone put a webcam on top of our rink. We're looking out over the softball field, and we see the 9-story west building,
which lines up with Peninsula, which many of the students live in, of course. And then we have the 7-story wing here of the east building, which lines up with Harbor Point. And then this is a 12-story wing, and it has
used it everywhere, actually. Okay. So the utility carpet and roadway relocation project, how many have been here more than a year? Yeah. Okay, so you've been living with this for a while. So have I. So have we all. So the utility carpet and roadway relocation project has been going on 4 or 5 years now. The good news is it is going to end in 2018. So hanging from our decommissioned parking garages in the 70s buildings are all the utilities for the university. And that has not been a good thing because we've had concrete problems down there, we've had a lot of outages, we've had issues. And so we are putting the utilities in a modern utility car around the perimeter of the university. We are connecting in to each building. We have pretty much piped into most of our buildings, and we are cutting over one utility at a time. So this is what you see underground. So over at U Drive South, so that's the area where the Fox Point dock is, this is what is underground. So this is what happened a few years ago over there. So you see they're putting in all of the utilities, the black pipes, the big huge black pipes are hot water pipes, the white pipes are chilled water. We've got duct banks, we've got vaults, we've got all kinds of utilities under this roadway. And then the roadway today looks like this, and we are on to final landscaping in this area. So we have put in almost 200 trees, and we have 200 more that are going in by the end of this fall planting season. We have more to do. So we've almost finished up this side of campus. We're really working on the other side of campus. And we're redoing the road system. So this is a, it's not a base-based coat, but it's a, it is not the finished coat of the roadway. When we're done with the entire roadway, redoing it, we're going to put down another layer of asphalt. We're going to restripe it. And we're going to have 5-foot bike lanes all around. We're going to have sidewalks all around, which anybody who's been here a while knows that we did not have sidewalks. And we will have these tree lawns that you see on the side of the roadway. So this is a photo shot from up at the top of the Resol, I have to confess. But so we're looking at parking lot D, but I'm such a geek. I like it because it shows the utility work going on here. So we've got 7 other vaults like this, and even the connection points to the utility. And this is, you know, hot water, chilled water. So that's what you see going on here. We are putting in our utilities that we need all around campus. And we're getting it. So this is roughly what our traffic pattern was September 5th. And here's what happens. We have to keep changing the traffic pattern. We have to keep changing our pedestrian walkways just to get this accomplished. So this is our next big change that's coming up, and it's coming up as soon as it's probably mid-October is where I'm hoping to get with this. I'm going to a construction impact planning meeting after this, so we'll hear more.
But essentially, we are putting in a new roadway, which we have actually put a segment of that roadway in. So just you drive south, east, north, and west. So you drive north, we are putting in a brand new roadway. And it connects to Mount Vernon Street as it does right now, goes to our parking lot D, but then it is going, we're expanding it straight over to U Drive East. And that's going to happen, like I said, as soon as mid-October. So that'll mean some more pedestrian changes. We're looking at what's the best way to get into Clark. Is this the best way to do it? In the final landscaping, this former clock parking lot becomes more of the drop-off area. So we're looking at how does that get accomplished. We have more utilities that have to go in here. We've got a lot of utilities coming down here. This is, believe it or not, Columbia Point is the name of this road. It has a name all by itself. But so there's a lot of work going here. We've got a vault over here behind University Hall that we're connecting. We're connecting that vault over here to this vault over there. So once we get that roadway in, we say we need to go to the Campus Center Garage or one of those places, we come in and go over here. And that's the next one.
And this is, again, shot from the top of the res wall, but this shows you the roadway that's it's being prepared. So essentially, this is the new drive from the north going by the Edward M. Kennedy Institute on the other side of the Archives building and straight up there. We have to do some work right in Archives parking area. That's going to happen for 4 to 6 weeks once we get this roadway up and running. And this is where we're aiming for. So by fall 2018, we're hoping to be right here. I mean, as I talk to you, sidewalks, bike lanes, tree lawns, those aren't swimming pools, those are bioretention areas that you see, those blue areas with water. Think green drainage, and that's what that is. We have a whole new campus. Well, they're calling it a commencement lawn. I don't know if commencement coming back, but in front of the campus there, probably next spring for planting season, we're going to slope this
lawn down to the harbor walk. And we're going to have an accessible route to the harbor walk. And this area here, which is currently a road, will become the Beacon's Walkway. And that'll go right down to the harbor walk. Again, it's an accessible route to the harbor walk. And we're going to be putting in another accessible route over here to the harbor walk. So things, you're going to slowly see things opening up. Elevator upgrades, I think we were talking about this. So we've got a big elevator project going on, and the elevators are being renovated in many of our 70s buildings. They're going to be it's begun in phases. In the first phase, we've got two elevators being worked on at the front of the McCormick building, and we've got one of the elevators in Wheatley at the front. And the other elevator, we're asking people to just go to 5 and 6 and use the back elevators. And then we'll flip at the end of October. About mid-October, we'll be done with this, and then we've got to get it inspected. And once we get them inspected, then we can flip and do the others. The elevators are so old in these buildings that we have been having problems getting parts. So that's why sometimes, especially if you know about the Wheatley freight elevator, it's been down for 3 years. So we're going to just move to each building. We'll be doing 3 at a time until they're all done in 2018. The Clark curtain wall, envelope, the exterior of the Clark building. So last year we replaced the gym. We had water, replaced the roof on the gym, not the gym. We had water intrusion in that building, so we replaced the roof. We're replacing the exterior, the metal cladding, the bricks, and beneath it we're putting in waterproofing. And so that's what you see going on over there. Inside, there's actually scaffolding. This is actually more of what it looks like. Inside, there's scaffolding as well because we're going to replace the skylights in there. They need it.
So, Holly, we have reached the 15-minute mark. Oh. So we are allocating 25 minutes for you. So if you would like to go over the important points and leave about 5 minutes for a Q&A session, that would be great.
I'm almost done. Okay. So this is the parking garage. So University Drive West is the area that's closed, and I could back up to it, but I'll do it in a bit. And on University Drive West, it looks a lot like this up here. You've got projects meeting projects. You've got the garage project meeting the UZR project. So we've completed pile driving, so we drive down to Bedrock to build our buildings, and we are we've put in the foundation. And starting on Saturday, we've got a giant crane coming. Gets assembled, comes in 17 parts, gets assembled, and then we put in big precast sections that'll take 3 months to install. And these precast sections, not unlike Legos, will assemble the garage. The garage will be pretty much done in May 2018. Whether they operated then, that's kind of an odd time, end of semester. We're looking at how the operations will work for the garage. And this is a rendering of the garage. So I can't talk about construction, I think, without talking about transportation. So we impact transportation around here, and we have been for a while. And, you know, we want to emphasize safety, driving, cycling, walking. You know, it's just tough out there with all the equipment and so forth. Public transportation, we've been emphasizing that. You know, people have been taking us up on it because this is the busiest year we've had with the shuttles. We've got 5,000 to 6,000 people that are moving every day on shuttle bus number one that comes from JFK. That goes from 6:30 to 10:30 at night. Shuttle bus number two, which is stops at the Clark and goes up to the JFK Library, that goes 8 to 6 p.m. We're part of the New Ride program, which is part of Mass Rides. You can sign up and get rewards for reporting your commute. And I want to remind people to use the app. So either the UMass Boston app or its mother, Translope, that shows you in real time where the buses are. And the semester discount was extended this year till 9/8, which was good because the T puts an 11% discount, but
they always give you some tough guidelines. I think for, you know, the next semester, November will be the deadline for the semester pass. You know, walking and biking on the harbor walk is a good thing to do if you're coming on by bike, either on the harbor walk or you can go on the roadway. But with the utility car or roadway relocation, we're putting in new bike racks all around. So you probably have seen some of them, some are covered, and we also are part of the Hubway ride sharing program. So the Hubway bike pad is actually, if you don't know where it is, well, there's one down at the JFK T station, and then there's one right below, sort of diagonally, the catwalk into the Integrated Sciences Complex. So we're asking people never to get dropped off in front of the campus center. I know that was something that was done in the past, but we're in the new world, we don't drop off there. We've got a great spot right in front of the Integrated Sciences complex for Lyft, Uber, or anyone to drop you off, and then you can go right into the nice ISC. Parking, we have.
So we are at the 20-minute mark, so we want to now move into, unless there's something else to wrap up.
I just wanted to just show people all the routes that are the satellite lots. Anybody, how many people drive? People drive? You know all about the satellite lots? Okay.
We're going to say that I will give you college contact if you have any other additional questions, but I'm going to limit this Q&A for about 5 minutes. So if anybody has any questions for our colleagues, so. Chair, I'm good.
So last year, you had made the same presentation, and I had asked about green paint to be on the bike lanes, because I know that's something a lot of cities around us do for their bike lanes, especially in busy traffic areas, just to differentiate, this is for driving, this is for bikes, especially in the nighttime, to have that neon green paint, it makes it more visible for drivers to see bikes. Is there a preference?
Write that down right now. As I said, I'm going to the construction company, right now, and I will ask about paint, because I do not know what.
I know you probably already have this thought, but the target time to reach end during the spring and the winter semesters have been unpredictable. Have those been taken into account possible, like having another like 15, having like shoulder high snow again, like taking into account the bigger timeline?
It has been. I mean, the for the utility corridor and roadway relocation project, they are totally, they've been living this for the last 4 years, so they're totally on top of it. As far as the residence hall, they are buttoning up the residence hall right now so that it'll all be enclosed and the work will be done inside. And the work that's going on in the garage, that big crane, and it takes a blizzard to stop that. I actually asked that question. So yes, is the short answer.
Thank you.
Hi, y'all. Just driving around the area in terms or at points of weather, like rain and stuff, and given the fact that we're on a landfill, and looking towards the future as it seems like you're doing with the master plan, have things been taken into account like potential flooding in the future and more invasion from the ocean and erosion, stuff like that?
Yes. So what you see out here is a great example, but essentially, when we are trenching, we are digging up a lot of the landfill. A lot of it is like compost. A lot of it has to get trucked off. So like 20% has to get trucked off, but essentially, we are reusing that material. And we're, for instance, in University Hall and for ISC, we built them up about 6 feet because the elevation out here is a little funny because of the landfill. And so if Hurricane Sandy hit here, like it did in New York, we'd be an island. So we actually have a little height to us, but essentially we're padding that. So we've got 6 feet that we're adding. this is going to be a land form out here because this is another area where we are targeting to have a building someday. So that will also be elevated. So the answer is yes, we're taking into consideration we're elevated. We have a lot of material that we can do that with. And just so you know, there's 2 feet of clean cover that goes on every landscaped area. It's below the road, it's 1 foot.
I will take a final question now. Is there a final question for a colleague?
I was just wondering, in terms of construction now and in the future, how do you think this space will affect student tuition and teachers at all?
So that gets into a big, big answer. But the short answer is we are capped by the Board of Trustees at 8%. So, in other words, 8% of our debt service, so if we had to make a mortgage payment, it would only be 8% of our budget, and we're capped there. With the residence hall, again, we went with a public-private partnership, and I have to say that Barry Mills and the new administration, that is what they are very focused on, is looking at keeping everything under control. So we've been there, and we're looking at it all, and there is a town hall. Next, I don't know if you all know this, next week, October 12th, and I believe it's 3 to 5, over in the Campus Center in the ballroom. So, I'm totally on budget. Totally on budget.
Any dialogue with the city? Yeah, I would love to say, please, we do have a schedule to keep. So, if you do have additional questions, let me know, and I will refer that to her and go back to. Thank you so much, Holly Sutherland. And again, if you have any other questions, please let me know and I will ask her.
So, and you can call me, write to me, whatever you want to do. And construction updates. Watch your construction updates. That's when we tell you when things are changing. We have a brown bag Tuesday, October 17th at noon, if you would like to come. It's going to be in the Campus Center ballroom. Thank you.
Okay, now moving on to the pressing matter, the TSR 2017-S001, the first bill of the semester, and it will be presented by President Trump.
Hello, everybody, again. So Speaker Henrique, Vice President Drew, and myself, along with assistance from Student Trustee Mankowski, drafted this bill in response to the UMass Building Authority and their response to Senator the New Jersey Authority of the First Suffolk District, which UMass Boston falls under. So the UMass Building Authority, their mission is to serve the University of Massachusetts and each of their 5 campuses through planning, financing, design, construction, acquisition, capital maintenance, and replacement of university buildings, infrastructure, and real estate. They are exempt from certain rules and regulations that apply to other people, and they are really what are building for University of Massachusetts. So legislation from Senator Linda Dorsey-Forty to create more oversight of the UMass Building Authority, so they aren't as, can't really just kind of do whatever they want, there's more people kind of understanding what they're doing and kind of in contact with them, and also to require any new building the academic base. This is a concern for UMass Boston, particularly because we have Bayside, which will be turned hopefully into more academic-based buildings for UMass Boston. That's what the students want. That's what Senator Corey wants. However, the UMass Building Authority came out and said, no, we shouldn't do that. That shouldn't be under our scope. So Linda Dorsey-Forty created legislation. If you guys read over ours, and basically our legislation is to support her decision to say, yes, the building should be academic-based. This, we will probably not see this happen in our career here at UMass Boston. This is for future students of UMass Boston. It is a way for UMass Boston to expand beyond the peninsula because we don't have much space left, and we need more space to build more academic buildings and whatnot and to expand our university. So this bill, again, is not for us, it's for future students. It's very important. Speaker Henrique, myself, Vice President Treat, as well as Senator Simakowski, have worked on this. I'm favorite, obviously, as well as Speaker Henrique and Vice President Treat. Do you guys have any questions for me?
Are there any questions for President McConnell on this topic?
Being that many of us will be here, how will this bill be remembered for future government members?
I think it's important. Obviously, we will have it on our government. I think it's important that people that are here, it's passed down from generation to generation with people. We will post about it. We will. We are in the works of having Senator Corey, who Vice President Dreef works with, to come here and kind of talk about it. So I think this is important. That's something we make known to the student body so more people know about it and get passed down from students and administration know about it as well.
Are there any other questions for President Trump?
I just want to make a comment. So it is important because they are making decisions right now. What's going to happen to Bayside? They're making those decisions right now. So this is why it's important that we choose, we see what's best for the future of our university and work on that.
What is the alternative they're providing? What is the alternative they're providing us besides being an educational facility? I'm just curious about that.
I'll just talk. So currently there's a request for proposal, request for information out on the Bayside site. So what happens is the building authority is responsible for putting up buildings and financing buildings, goes out and says, we're looking for ideas as to what to put on the property. So it's an 8-page document that says, quote, is a new day Harvard Square. So the idea is that while the building authority and the president's office is looking for ideas as to what to do with the property, to kind of be able to, as students and as representatives of kind of the 17,000 students that go here, offer our perspective as to what academic facilities, what facilities the students can use and need rather than something that won't. So the alternative is, I don't know how many people are familiar, in February the building authority was on that discussion for a soccer stadium there. And that's really what this legislation that, I'm sorry I didn't get to you, but the two bills that are put in the Senate are a reaction by the community, by the campus. Senator Ford, who's very involved in UMass Boston, really didn't think the stadium would be in the best interest of students and the community. So it's a reflection of the soccer stadium, but there's no X. This is the alternative to an academic building. It's still a request process. If you have other questions after the meeting as well, please.
Are there any questions for President Trump? Seeing none, is there a motion to move to a vote?
Motion to move to a vote.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor to move to a vote, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say nay. We are now at the voting stage. All those in favor of adopting this resolution, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say nay. It passes. Given that we do have one other item on new business, I will reserve that for an SGA and move it into old business. And now we're moving to the open forum section. Would anybody like to speak during the open forum? Shelby.
I want to introduce myself to those that don't know me. I am Shelby Harris. I am the advisor to the student government. I'm the Associate Dean of Students. I'm located on the third floor of the Student Activities Office. Many of you I have seen around. Many of you are also new faces, so welcome. You've probably received too many emails from me already, but if you need anything, that's where I am located, so I'll be seeing you every Senate Wednesday. As I say, like death and taxes, it comes, so. But honestly, I'm looking forward to working with all of you, and thanks for running and joining the group, so welcome aboard.
Thank you, Shelby. Is there anything else
about earlier about the people who were talking in front of Campus Center and what they were saying. I think that I understand this is a public campus, but I think that if someone's going to come onto our campus, there should be at least kind of an understanding that if you are insulting the student body or the majority of people feel uncomfortable, I didn't pay attention to him. I was walking by him. I saw the signs. I felt like this is not my thing. I'm not going to want to listen to it. But I felt generally uncomfortable with the tone he was using. And I feel that while it's public, there shouldn't, no one should feel uncomfortable trying to walk from a corner to a U-Haul, trying to get the class, and they're just, it's an uncomfortable environment for all. Things on the sheet that, like, shouldn't have a
background. All right, thanks so much for bringing this topic up. Of course, we do have, I just want to make this point and then I'll get to your concerns. This point is that, yes, we are a public university, so we do have to respect, you know, federal laws, et cetera, public, you know, free speech, et cetera. That being said, we do have a student code of conduct. And you know, inappropriate behavior may not be something that everybody likes, but there are limits to what people can say on this campus as well. So if you have a problem with that, we can definitely investigate more into what's going on, and if it's an ongoing, and you know, somebody's harassing somebody instead of just saying what they think, that's a different story. So I'd love to talk to you afterwards more. You get more details about this, we can look into it. And yeah, we will definitely like bring this up and go in further about you know addressing this problem.
Hi, so actually I too was very stirred by the what was said. So I inquired about the table was actually on the other side. I talked to Georgina, the Melinda. She's the Vice Chancellor of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. They basically deal with a lot of, like, if people want to come and talk on campus, if there's any issues concerning immigration, things like that. She's really great. And we basically talked about, okay, what are the legalities of this? And technically, they had every right to be on our campus saying what they were saying. I did point out, though, that the targeting was unnecessary. The targeting, you know, like you were, other senators were saying earlier, is inappropriate. So she invited me to a webinar, and I opened it up to everyone as well, concerning where in which, like, what was the line for people to what they can say and what they can't say. I'm also investigating the legalities of it since we are a public institution, we do follow the federal law. And so on and so forth. So also, I will extend this out. If you do have any questions, please you can talk to me as well. And I will relay those questions over to Georgina. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Simmons. Do you have a comment?
Yes.
It doesn't work.
I can just speak up. Yeah. So I think the issue is also maybe that there could be a way for us to protect students or warn students if there's something that they're going to find offensive, because I did see a lot of students, especially LGBTQ students or Muslim students or women who were very offended by what was being said. And this is our campus. We can't, it's not like we can choose to just go away. We kind of had to walk by that. So if there was some way that we could actually tell people of what was in front of them so that we can avoid some of the conflicts that were there, or that we can find ways, or we can, I don't know if we have the right to tell them where they can set up the table or when they can do it. Because I do agree with free speech, they have the right to their opinions, but they should not everybody should have to be subjected to it.
That is one of the designated protest area for folks who come on campus, and while we're working on a fine-tuning the policy that we have, we can definitely talk more on this. By the iron worker on the plaza is for folks to set up as long as they are. I mean, I know that it's disruptive and it's upsetting to a lot of people. We've had a lot of conversations about what constitutes disruption, material disruption of classes, academic mission, time, place, manner. But believe it or not, that iron worker is the location. And so we ask groups to give us 5 days notice, but clearly it's the element of surprise that they're looking for. So I think your feedback is going to be good for us to have as we're continuing with this process of policies, verifying support for students, things like that.
Okay. Senator Simmons, you are a strong question for a person because you want to get a very high comment. Vice President Tariq, you had a comment.
So I know that all eight kind of like mentioned briefly for the end of our presentation, but Chancellor Mills and Vice Chancellor Kathy Kramer, she's the Vice Chancellor of Administration and Finance. She is holding a town hall on October 12th, 2:30 to 4 p.m. That's right after our, that's the day after our next GA. So if you guys have any questions or just interested, please know that I will be there. But just letting you guys know that it's happening. So it's really nice if you have more questions about the budget and some questions you want to ask.
Thank you, Vice President Tariq. Are there any other comments or questions from the board? Senator Small.
Yeah, I'll speak up. So on the topic of our guests today, we do already have things like you said, Senator Carl.
Yeah.
You had said you had something that came up to you and it was crying. My advice to all the senators, so if you don't know, the health services has a counselor set. So if somebody does need a counseling and has obviously suffered, especially from having traumatic trouble on mental, then they do have counselors that, that can help these people. In a way, by laws, we're not going to be able to stop these things. On a personal note, I do believe exposure to these things, even on a campus, is a good thing because people are going to see these things in the rest of the world when they go out and travel and do business with people. So seeing it here and learning that it really isn't going to hurt you, and they really don't have all that power that you think they have, is a good place to learn and start. And then when you're out in the world, you'll be a little stronger for it. So showing people where to go to the counselors so you can teach them how to be strong from the people, both mentally and physically. This is something we should really do to guide the people.
Thank you, Senator Small. Are there any other comments or questions during the open forum?
Since it's not widespread legal action taken on this, it was a spectacle out there. And the guy was, but perhaps we could put in place an advisory system for these types of extremist demonstrations, or even put out a statement to reassure students that we support religious freedom and that these kind of groups on campus would not hold any influence about it. Yeah. So we got the ability to go forward.
I will motion for the topic we discuss in open forum about this guest and this issue in general to be added to old business for next general session. New business.
Is there a second on the motion?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
This item will be added to new business of the next year. Are there any other topics or comments or questions from open forum?
Parking at Bayside and at Morrissey Lot especially, is an amazing hassle. And the biggest reason is the booths that you have to go through. So a single line file of 30 or 50 cars, what bus that's off, go out through the booths. It took me 15 minutes to get to parking at Bayside because traffic was slowed down by a single booth. And their only purpose for this is to collect $6. And I wonder if it would be better for the student body to not collect the $6 and to let people park for free at Bayside Lot and at Morrissey Lot. This is caused by the construction, and it is a huge inconvenience to people who drive.
Thank you for that comment. We will get that information to you so we can address this next meeting in more detail. Are there any other comments or questions?
Yes. I've noticed a lack of structure in terms of when you get on the shuttles, particularly the JFK station, not so much the campus center. In terms of when people get up and get on at the front door, sometimes they allow people on the back door, and sometimes they don't. Not